So, welcome, good afternoon. What a great turnout. Boat Show Brunch, the idea is that you can come over, rest your tired feet, grab something to eat, refuel, and just prepare and rest, prepare for the afternoon of browsing around the boat show. So it's a long walk. So, Boat Show Brunch, over the last 10 days or so of the boat show, has brought some pretty eclectic conversation with some real characters from the boating industry. And we have three fabulous characters here today to speak to and chat to. First of all, in the orange trousers, Sam Petty, founder of David Watson Silk. Welcome along. Sam Jefferson on the end is author of Gordon Bennett and the first yacht race across the Atlantic. And sitting to my left, Monty Halls, who's a TV presenter and adventurer. And we'll get on to that subject a little later on. First of all, I suppose the theme that ties this all in is that Sam's book is pretty much about the start of the Gatsby era and these multimillionaire gentlemen who created and had yachts built to race across the Atlantic, and that's what his story is about. Sam makes the most amazing silk pocket squares and scarves as worn by gentlemen and inspired by that era. And Monty does a lot of work with adventurers and explorers and is one himself, and we'll be talking about the sort of the leadership lessons that you can get from that. But really, it's almost like we've returned to the 19th century in many ways. Let's just start with your book, Sam. So Gordon Bennett and the first yacht race across the Atlantic. This is just out in paperback, which is why I've got the paperback version, but it's on hardback as well. Love the cover. Sounds like a great story. Just give us an overview of that.
Well, I mean, it's basically, it's 1866 is the year, and basically three very wealthy Americans were in one of their gentlemen's clubs in New York, and they were getting drunk on brandy, as they did, and they kind of got into an argument about who had the best yacht. They all had racing schooners, which was the kind of yacht of the time, and they each thought they had the better one. As they got more and more drunk, they decided the only way to decide this was to sail across the Atlantic, which was pretty much unheard of at the time and considered quite dangerous. So they woke up in the morning with bad hangovers, but instead of just saying, well, that was a stupid thing to do, they went ahead. And being wealthy and always getting their own way, this was kind of in late November. They decided to have it in December, so they raced across the Atlantic in December.
Wrong
terrible time of year, really unwise. And it was the first ever kind of offshore race, so it was the beginning, the birth of offshore racing. So that was kind of
this guy was so notorious that this Gordon Bennett is, Gordon Bennett, it is him. And why did that become a phrase then?
Gordon Bennett, he became a bit of a celebrity just because he was one of these extremely wealthy people. He was always in the gossip columns and stuff, and he was just a very much larger than life character. I mean, his father was a proprietor of the New York Herald, so he's sort of like the James Murdoch, but much more exciting than James Murdoch. And he basically had a real weakness for drink, so he was quite sensible during the day, but at night he turned into this kind of ridiculous party animal and got into some terrible scrapes. He eventually was kind of excommunicated from New York society he got engaged to a society girl, got drunk at his engagement party, no, New Year's Eve party at the family home, and mistook the fireplace for the toilet and went for a wee in the fireplace in front of the prospective in-laws. So after that, he scandalized New York society so much that he moved to Paris. But that's kind of, there were all sorts of things he did, but that was one of the origins of Gordon Bennett.
And I mean, the great thing about the book is it does go into a lot of detail as to the characters that are central to the plot. And I just love this piece about Gordon Bennett where it says, full to the back teeth with the good stuff, he'd become so braced by an exhilarating night ride that he'd ripped off his clothes and rattled through the streets on top of his coach, coolly puffing his cigar, naked as the day he was born, barring a white silk top hat. Sounds fabulous, doesn't it?
Just a standard Friday night.
Standard Friday night.
Standard Friday night.
That's right. And, well, maybe he could have also worn a pocket square or
Absolutely.
One of your scarves.
Absolutely, yeah.
This is an era that was full of explorers and adventurers, and often people like Gordon Bennett would have financed their expeditions. Monty, are we seeing, I suppose we are really, a return to that with a lot of TV adventurers and explorers?
Yes, it's one of the great questions that surrounds adventuring, latter-day adventuring and exploration. Can you still do it? These guys were pioneers, genuine pioneers. They put themselves in genuine danger and with genuine risks that if things went wrong, they couldn't be rescued. And one of the big arguments nowadays is, does exploration still exist? Because pretty much anywhere around the world now, you've got GPS, you've got satellite phones. People can get to you pretty much everywhere. If you look at the great explorers, Douglas Mawson, Shackleton, you know, all of these guys, they were out there on their own. And there was a good chance you were going to die. Mallory and Irving, when they did their Everest expedition, I think 1923 was the last one. This was the age just after the First World War. It was an age of sacrifice, and it's what Victorian gentlemen did. You know, they went off and they died for their country. And so it was considered almost the right thing to do back then. But it's a question that's been explored many times. Does exploration still exist? The reason we're all here is that we love the sea and we love the marine environment. And my answer to that question is always, just look at the sea. The average depth of the ocean, 2.5 miles around the world. If you removed all the land, you'd still have a film of sea around the world that's 1.5 miles thick. If you dropped Everest into the Marianas Trench, you'd still have 1 mile from summit to surface. And we've explored 5% of the deep sea. So exploration very much does exist. Now, I say that to the next generation. In this modern age, we shot a film, a couple of years ago called Lost Worlds for Discovery, and should have been called Lost Wages because the production company making it went bust and I never got paid, so Lost Wages. But
that description of the TV industry in general.
But the whole idea of it was to find places around the world where camera crews and scientists had never been, and we found it a surprisingly easy thing to do. So cave systems, maybe 20-25% of cave systems have been explored. The arboreal zone in the jungle, we know nothing about that. That's the tree canopy in the jungle. We know nothing about it. So yeah, there's plenty of places you can still explore, and I think there's plenty of places you can go off the beaten track. But the final thing to say about that, long answer, is I think exploration is intensely personal. And we did a project a few years ago, the Blue Hole in Dahab, killed 100 divers, the Blue Hole, so they say. We wanted to find out why. And as we went in with all our amazing technology and rebreathers and communications kit and support divers and all that, I looked across and there was a tourist just stepping in who was snorkeling for the first time. He was quite a big guy, big old unit, and plainly enjoyed a Ginsters or two. And he was being shoved in by his wife, basically, to go and do some snorkeling. And he'd never done it before. And I thought, who's the biggest explorer here? Is it us, with all our gear and all our kit, doing this exploration of the Blue Hole? Or is it that guy going snorkeling? And actually, it's that guy. Because he's going into a new world, you know? So I think it's very personal.
A very personal experience.
But these guys were extraordinary. I mean, what a thing to do. And shows the naivety, doesn't it? As you say, doing it in December, you know, just shows the naivety of and the power of money and wealth of thinking, well, we're immortal because, you know, we're wealthy.
They're used to getting their own way.
There are a lot of similarities, actually, between your description of society then and society now. We'll come to that in a moment. But you're talking about pioneers and, you know, the personal taste. Sam, you're pioneering a very personal taste because these are some amazing products.
Just
give us a quick overview of them.
Well, basically, I love art and I love fashion. And so over the last 2 years, I've combined the two. And I found my favorite British artists and put their work onto silk. And so I'm making silk pocket squares and scarves, which I absolutely love.
So let's have a look at some, because until you see them, you kind of, it doesn't quite.
So I've tried to be sort of slightly boat showy and London-y.
Because a lot of these designs have got boat designs on. Here's one.
So this, for example, is Whitby Harbour, let's get it the right way up for you. So this is a large scarf. They come in two different sizes. There's a pocket square and a scarf.
Whitby Harbour, did
Whitby
you say?
Harbour, yeah. And the idea is that they're all very different styles of art, different designs, different artists. And the idea is that hopefully everyone likes one. Everyone likes the colour, or they might like the location. And they've been on holiday there.
And I think the important thing is also, it's a very British product. That's what that's
absolutely
important
yeah.
to you.
It is important to me. Like, I've tried to create a British brand. Sorry, I'm not doing a very good a job of showing them around, but I've tried to create a British brand, and therefore they're made in Britain. They're by British artists. The designs are all locations in Britain.
Well, this is obviously London, and I think it's one of a few London scenes you've got. So
yes.
they're British artists. How do you go about the design process? How do they do them? Paint them especially for you? What medium is it?
Basically, I mean, they're all meant to be very different, and so therefore everyone likes a different one. But I find them by maybe I might find the artist online, or I might go to an art fair. And actually now sort of artists are coming to find me as well, which is
well,
lovely.
That's all satisfying.
and so the tables are turned slightly.
I could see them being sported by someone on a transatlantic race in December on their own yacht.
There we go. Well,
I hopefully. Could see you there, Sam. I could very much see you there.
So this is another London design called Thames People, showing all the people on the way on their commutes, etc.
Again, London, but a very different look and a very different design.
Absolutely, yeah. So that's a Sorkham design by a lady called Claire Henley.
So it's where?
Sorkham in Devon.
Oh, yeah.
And I mean, I've tried to sort of get quite a good geographical spread across UK, but I'm constantly looking for new artwork and artists. At the moment, there are 40 designs. And 40.
Yep.
And there are 20 artists.
Now, does it follow that, because you do scarves as well, so you've got three products at the moment, is that right?
Yes, yeah, there's the big scarf that I've been waving around showing you, then there's this long
scarf.
And the idea is that's a unisex product.
Okay.
And then there are the pocket squares.
Now, the question, I'm sure Monty, as a former Royal Marine, is used to dressing up like this for the officers' club. How do you put that in your pocket? How do you wear it?
Well, I mean, this is the million-dollar question, really, and everyone has their own sort of way of doing it, and there's probably sort of books written
or
on it as well.
Pocket.
But so yeah, pocket. I'll dress you. So basically, what I always do, although like I say, there's a million and one ways, is I just pick the middle like that and go like that. And then shove it in the pocket. I mean, so it's as simple as that, really. And I'd love to sort of keep talking about it, but I personally think it's have it how you want, have sort of as much in, as much out.
He's done it
flamboyant.
Before,
yeah, I mean, what it takes me quite a long time to get dressed in the morning now, because I have to decide out of my 40 pocket squares which one I should wear. But
the important thing is clearly not to make sure nothing matches.
Yeah,
that's what takes time.
No comment.
I knew Sam would be colourful, so the best I could do was some stripy socks.
Very nice.
I think they're quite. They match all the rest of it. Great. So clearly the silk is not English British, but the rest.
No, I mean it's as British as it can possibly be, being a silk product. The fabric comes over from China, and then they're printed, cut, and hand rolled in Brighton. So I'm trying to make it as British as silk could ever be.
The best silk is Chinese.
Well, exactly.
We've got the best silk coming over, but everything else is made in Britain.
Yes.
In Brighton, in fact.
In Brighton,
okay.
Yeah.
Do you use Southern Rail to deliver?
Anyway.
Yeah, many logistics obstacles.
Yes. Let's hope the company expansion doesn't depend on that. Okay. Do you think this is something Gordon Bennett would wear?
I think he was quite foppish, so yeah, I mean, a silk hat was obviously his favourite, but yeah, I think he would have, he was definitely a follower of fashion, so yeah.
How did you get the idea for the book?
I was just writing an article for a magazine called Classic Boat, originally, about the first transatlantic race, so it was only going to be short, and then I discovered Gordon Bennett, and the more I read about him, the more ridiculous he became, And I thought, well, there's a book in this, not just an article. So that was it just kind of expanded.
I've touched on the detail that you go into on the characters and especially that first evening where they're drinking themselves stupid in their gentleman's club in New York. How did you make some of that up? Or is it, I mean, how can you possibly get those details?
Fortunately, the gentlemen involved were all very wealthy and very well known, and they were kind of the celebrities of their time, so they were the subject of gossip columns and stuff. So it was all, there was a lot about them that was very well documented in newspapers and stuff. With Gordon Bennett as well, I mean, I found stuff, there was a little pamphlet written by one of his lovers, so it was kind of a kiss and tell about him, so I got a lot of insight into him through things like that. So there was an awful lot of, there was a surprising amount that you could find.
It's interesting, isn't it, how I guess it's no different to doing writing in, 150 years' time, trying to find information on Richard Branson or Abramovich or Larry Ellison and writing a book about their behaviour. But equally, there are similarities in just society in general. When I was reading it, there were whole paragraphs that sounded like you were talking about today with financial crash, how people were making money out of the crash, but others were really struggling. There is a similarity.
Yeah, that's what I found when I was writing the book. I mean, everywhere I went, I kind of stumbled upon some parallel to what's going on now in a way. I mean, it was the beginning of the Gilded Age, which Mark Twain called it, the author, but it was kind of a period of great wealth on the outside and things perhaps not quite so good. A lot of inequality, essentially. And there was a slight feeling that society is going a little bit back that way, certainly when you've got someone like Trump in his golden marble mansion in charge of the US.
So tell us about the race then. They decided to race their boats across the Atlantic, and although we've talked in terms of them, you know, being playboys, being drunks, having a great time, actually the race cost people's lives.
It did, yeah. And there were three owners. Only Bennett, actually, when it came down to it, agreed to go across on his yacht and race. The other two said they were too busy making money, so they bailed out.
So they set it up.
They set it up.
Set their men off.
They sent their men off
across in winter
with their yacht,
and then stayed at home.
And then they stayed at home to kind of. So only Bennett went across, and the race was very close. They were fairly fortunate with the weather until midway across, where they predictably got hit by a severe storm. And unfortunately, two of the yachts, Bennett's yacht actually hove to and stopped. Another yacht, the Vesta, that ran before it, pretty much out of control, but they were all right. But the third one, the Fleetwing, was kind of inundated by a huge wave, and the entire watch was washed overboard, and five men died as a consequence, which, when you read the reports at the end of the race, is barely touched on. It was kind of just, you know, they were expendable, they were just sailors, so that was the end of it. And the race carried on. The Fleetwing was fairly demoralized and kind of dropped back after that, understandably. So it became between the Vesta and the Henrietta, the two yachts in the race. The Henrietta was Bennett's yacht, and he was just trailing the Vesta as they approached the Isles of Scilly, but the Vesta made a poor choice, and in the Henrietta actually slipped by without them even noticing, and then raced up the channel and came in and won. So Bennett, even though technically his yacht was considered the slowest, actually came in first, which everyone was quite pleased about because he was the owner who'd actually competed. So, got all the plaudits.
And coined the phrase, Gordon Bennett, he's won it.
Gordon, yeah. Yeah. But he actually met Queen Victoria in Cowes when they arrived, and everyone was very worried he was going to do something inappropriate, but I think they steered him clear of the alcohol and he was fine.
Right. So, it was a race that caught the imagination of the people on both sides of the Atlantic. It was a big deal.
It was, yes, yeah. I mean, they both made a big a fuss about it, and the British were initially quite cynical, but when they all arrived, they were like... And it actually, the British and Americans were not at a good point at that. It was just after the Civil War, and the British hadn't really helped out the Union a great deal. They'd actually helped the Confederates at points, and there was a real diplomatic impasse, really. And this race did help in a way because it did bring them together, and it was the start of that kind of special relationship, really. So it was a signpost to all sorts of things in a way.
So fun times if you were the right people with the right money, difficult times for a lot of people that period of history. Not very different in many ways from today. I think you're talking about the revolution of the steam engine with them. We've obviously got the revolution of the internet, the digital age. But that sort of ties in with something you're trying to do and help young people with leadership and how to push themselves forward in difficult times.
Brilliant segue.
I thought so.
Very good. You're a pro. It's interesting, you know, hearing stories like that. It would have come down to the fundamental quality of the men, and I don't know if there are any women on the boats as well, but of the crews on those boats.
Unlikely.
Of discipline, of leadership, of self-management, of all of those, you know, communication, all those good stuff. And for years and years now, I've been delivering packages to businesses and to schools and colleges where you go and you do a bit of leadership training. And it's dawned on me over time that the best way for an organization to develop leadership is from within the organization. It's not to get a consultant to come in from outside and get paid ludicrous sums of money to go and I'm shooting myself in the my own foot here, I isn't it? But so about a year and a half ago, I did a presentation for a whole bunch of headmasters, headmistresses for schools, 350 schools. And the thing they flagged up was that young people don't really get exposure to leadership training nowadays en masse. And you're absolutely right, the digital age, you know, screens, et cetera, are those qualities still important? So I went and did a bit of research into industry and found that 84% of business leaders think that attitude is the most important thing in young people getting a job. 90% of them, this was a CBI survey, think that leadership should be an essential part of the curriculum in the UK. So we've started a revolution, and he says grandly, but my stand is just the other side of Sunseeker. So a lot of people with Rolexes and very nice blazers are walking straight past my stand. We're in the shadow of one of the Sunseekers. But we've launched a thing called Leaderbox, which is basically a way of training young people. All kids in the UK should get exposure to it. It's a fundamental skill, and it's such a huge life skill. So from the age of 6, right the way through the curriculum up to school leaving age, and then within businesses as well, there's one called Leaderbox Pro for businesses. So basically, it's a system of just saying, right, there you go. You can develop your own leadership culture using your ethos, your values.
So you don't go in and teach.
Absolutely not.
So without giving too much away,
I'll give anything away.
How does it work?
It's called Leaderbox because the reason is there's also a very difficult, complex subject. This leadership, very soft skills. No one can really define it. There's a million different definitions. And I was driving away from one meeting when we were trying to put together this curriculum of how we delivered leadership training to yacht crews, to anyone who runs a business. You know, it's such a valuable thing. And I was driving away from a meeting and I thought, you know, I've been playing rugby for 30 years. I'm an ex-Marine. I get hit on the head a lot. This needs to be simple, really simple. And so we put it in a box, but it's a box that's taken us 100 grand to design because everything has to go with a curriculum.
That's even more impressive than Sam's boxes here.
And make sure it's eminently deliverable. So it's a series, it's 10 hours of scenarios, games, exercise. It can all be done in a really small space. It can all be done on a tabletop. And it follows a set pattern that develops key skills that are associated with leadership. And we had a meeting with the Lord Mayor of London yesterday to talk about the project being rolled out in London, essentially. So it's a philanthropic project to try and create the next generation of British leaders, really. But also social mobility, mental health in young people, all this sort of stuff. I really think it addresses that. So
hopefully one day, every child going through our school system will have
exposure to a bit of leadership training. We're not saying everyone's leaders, but what we're saying is everyone benefits from exposure to training that will increase their confidence, give them a sense of worth, give them a sense of direction, the ability to communicate, the ability to plan. All this sort of stuff's really essential. And I've toured loads of schools talking. We're working with 19 schools putting this together, and loads of businesses and organizations, elite sports teams, things like that. And I've toured loads of schools giving lectures about this. And I start the lecture by saying, right, who here thinks they're a leader? And loads of lads put their hands up. And in all the talks I've done around schools, from the ages of about 12 to about 16, I've yet to have one girl put her hand up. And I think there's a terrible divide between a confidence of the sexes there as well. And that needs to be addressed, because the best leaders I've come across are invariably women. So
out of interest of all the, you know, the boys that put their hands up, presumably there's some sort of, you then spend some time with them. Out of those who put their hands up, how many do you come away thinking, well, yeah, he might make a leader one day?
Oh, no, we're all leaders in our own area, you know, without a shadow of a doubt. And it might not be, leadership isn't standing in front and shouting the loudest, it's exploring your own potential, having the ability, confidence to make your own decisions, you know, deciding your own path in life. And, you know, some guy who, the classic leadership training nowadays is helmet and harness, outward bound, Duke of Edinburgh sort of stuff. That doesn't suit all kids, not all kids like that. Would Bill Gates have liked that? Probably not. Would Richard Branson, Steve Jobs? Probably not. These are the people who shape our society nowadays, and they're ignored by the system at the moment. So we're trying to create something that just means that all of them get exposure to leadership.
On that, I just want to bring Sam, because we're running out of time. How old are you, Sam?
27.
27, okay. So basically, you've done all sorts of jobs, but you've now set up on your own.
Yes.
Showing real entrepreneur skills, entrepreneurial skills, and you're building a company. What are the hurdles and what are the skills that you think you need to do that?
Well, good question. I think...
I mean, there might even be skills that you feel you don't have.
Well, there are many of those, but for me, the hardest thing, and a thing that a lot of people say initially, is actually just sort of making the plunge and going for it. And actually, that's probably the hardest thing. It took me quite a long time. For 5 or 6 years, you know, I always wanted my own business, and I was doing various jobs, this, that, and the other. I worked in television a lot. But then it took me that long to find something I had the confidence in to actually go for it and start up. And so my advice, not that you asked for my advice really, but my advice would be to go for it and actually just to make the plunge and do it.
Well, it's a really interesting point you make there, Sam, and Alec as well, and Sam as well, that that's a big part of what we're trying to do, is say to people, just give it a go, trust yourself, back yourself. And so many young people nowadays don't have the confidence to do that, to rise above their circumstances. And it's magnificent what you've done here. You've taken a real punt. You've backed yourself and said, you know, I'm passionate about this. Writing a book, I know how hard it is to get published. It's so hard. And there's always people telling you it's not going to happen. And both Sam and Sam have just backed themselves. And that's what we're trying to get young people to do.
The first thing you have to do, though, is grow a tash like that.
Well, it helps.
That's step one, really, of
it's
success.
It's inspired me, I have to say. Yeah.
Or big sides, like big lamb chop sides, like Sam. Yeah.
And as a former Royal Marine, you know, do your guys still, your officers?
That is a truly magnificent tash. But what we always used to try and do in Norway when we did our Arctic training, we'd all try and grow moustaches. You could have icicles off them. That was the cool thing, have icicles.
Well,
I'll definitely follow you into battle with that tash, without a doubt.
Right, guys. So, first of all, give us an idea of cost prices. So
the retail prices, scarf. So for the large scarf, they're £139. And then for the pocket squares, like this, are £39. They can be bought on my website. Am I doing a sales pitch here?
Yes, or
they can be bought on my website at davidwatson.uk.
Scarf?
This long scarf is £79.
How should I wear this, though? Because I know I can wear it as I want.
Well, I mean, you can just drape it over like that, actually.
Fashionistas here, how does one wear a silk scarf? Like, tie it up like that? Tuck it in like a cravat?
There you go, why not?
Yeah, we do that. I'm sure it goes very well with the blue gingham.
They are unisex, Alex, but you're managing to make that look very feminine.
Yeah. and the little it comes with a little brush.
Yeah,
so for my makeup.
Well, yeah, exactly, for your makeup along with your scarf. But every design comes with, well, this little brush, as you said, but more to the point, it comes with information about the artist, because for me, the artists are the core of the brand, of my brand. Their story and what they have to say is important. So every product comes in the box with these swing tags that tell you how to look after it and more about the artist and the design and location.
Great. It's absolutely, it's a gorgeous product.
Thank you.
Absolutely stunning. I love the whole packaging, the whole branding, the whole look. Fantastic. So congratulations, Sam. And you'll be around. So if anyone wants to pick one up, it'd be a perfect present.
There you go.
Meanwhile, on to Gordon Bennett, $8.99, paperback edition. Or splash out. Where can they get them?
There's a Chartco stand, so it's way down the other end towards all the charter companies.
Down the right side, down towards the boating lake.
Yes, but I'm signing copies today. So
you're signing copies today?
Yeah, I expect to be mobbed later.
Fantastic. And your stand is, as you've said, near the Sunseeker stand.
Yeah, it's dead easy. If you walk down there, opposite gate 8, if you look at these, just opposite gate 8, and it's the world debut of the Leader Boxes, the boat show. So it's there in all its glory.
Right, we have a load of other shows this afternoon here at the boat show. Monty will be back for Question of Sailing. Let's do this backwards. So at 3 o'clock, we've got Question of Sailing, our panel quiz show. We've changed the questions from last week, so you won't know the answers. We had great fun last week. And there's some physical challenges, and it's a real laugh. So think Question of Sport with a bit more, even more fun than you get from that. So that's at 3 o'clock. At 1:15, we have Sailing Uncovered Live. That's with Sam Davis and Dee Kafari, two legendary female ocean racers, who are going to talk about, well, amongst other things, the Vendée Globe. And we'll have a cross to Race HQ in Paris to get the latest on how the only Briton in the race, Alex Thompson, is doing. That's at 1:15. We've got fashion shows in between those, so loads going on. They won't run out of coffee, so you can keep coming backwards and forwards throughout the afternoon. But for now, thanks to Monty and the two Sams, it's been an absolute pleasure. Thank you very much, and thank you for listening.